For those of you who don't know, we've added two new members to our committee, Denise Mason representing the Planning Board and Peter Law representing the Conservation Commission. And so maybe we could just go around the room and do quick introductions so everybody knows everybody. I'm Chris Curtis, and I'm the MVP coordinator for the town. And maybe go your way.
M.A. Swedland. I am on the Energy Committee. I think that's who I'm representing here.
Chris Nolan. I'm the Assistant Town Administrator.
Lane Fiden, consultant helping with the MVP 2.0 process.
Tim Hill, Chief Select Board.
Carolyn Ness, Select Board. Board of Health with Tim.
Sewer Commissioner.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Deputy dog officers, whatever else.
You should get a hat that says that, Carolyn. Sewer Commissioner.
No, I don't want it. Believe me.
Kevin Scarborough, Public Works.
Pete Law, Conservation Commission.
Denise Mason, Planning Board.
Well, thanks, everybody, for being here. So we've got two municipal vulnerability preparedness projects that the town is working on currently, MVP 2.0 and the MVP Action Grant. And we're going to spend a little bit of time on each of those today. Starting off with MVP 2.0, we've been working on a first phase of that, which is called the groundwork phase. And there is a report that Wayne has been working on for us that kind of summarizes the research and work that we've been doing so far. And Wayne, I'm going to maybe just kind of turn it over to you and ask you to summarize and lead that discussion, if that's okay.
Sure. So I don't think there's probably any surprises for anybody here. You know, we had to follow the state's format to identify which communities are underrepresented, which communities are often not at the table in the process. You all, I'm sure, know the demographics of Deerfield much better than I do. You know, wealthy, far above median income community, but certainly lots of concentrations of challenging groups. I think 15% of the population is below 200% of poverty level, which is what the state wants us to consider as groups who are economically challenged. The biggest, large senior population, interesting for me, and again, I'm sure you all know this, the number of people over 65 is a little bit higher than the state as a whole, 20% of your population, as opposed to 15% of the state. And yet you have a really high median age. So you're one of the oldest communities in the Commonwealth. And it's not so much because the over 65, so that's a factor. You have a lot of people in their 40s and 50s. And so what you really don't, I mean, obviously you have students at all the schools here, but outside of that, your population of 20 and 30 year olds is pretty small. So in terms of outreach, you need to think about what are the groups, who's represented. People who are older, you want to make sure you're getting, but I think almost by definition, looking at the composition of the boards, you already have that demographic, so you don't have to work for that. People, one of the choice, and then before I go into details, one of the choices you have going forward is, who do you actually want on this core committee? Who do you want to expand it to cover? Or who do you want to include later when we're doing enhanced outreach? So we've done the first part, which is identifying populations. The next stage, the part B of this is, okay, how do we actually attract people in the process? And so youth is a good example. You have youth are really important, even though it's a relatively small number as a percentage of your population. You could think about somebody representing youth to serve on this committee, or we could do a really good job of doing outreach to get youth, you know, focus group at the high school or something like that later on to get in the process. So obviously people who are below that 200% of poverty level, same thing, it's important to get them represented somehow, but you have choices how to do that. And then, you know, the biggest challenge is migrant farm workers are certainly a big part of your workers here, but very few, if any, live here, right? We didn't see any in the schools. Most live in Holyoke, Springfield, or Montague. Those are the big population centers for migrant workers. So again, if you want their voices, You could get them on the core committee, but frankly, I think that would be extremely difficult for someone who's just a day laborer, or you can think about an outreach session later on in the process. I can go into more detail if anyone wants, but that's sort of a big overview in the process.
Well, I think it's really important to get youth involved on this committee because it's their future. And I know it is my granddaughter, but I know Cece Yazwinski already put in a letter of interest, and she is truly interested. And her firm, obviously, is a multi-generational firm and has been, you know, farm for hundreds of years. So I mean, we certainly should appoint her. And see, and I would love to have someone from Frontier. You know, we've been trying to identify and reach out to somebody in the public schools as well. And I feel like that's really important. And then I still would like us to do a focus group with youth, not really any different than our climate forums that we tried to reach out to the community, where we did initially an overview, then we had the pandemic and got set back, but then tried to focus on people individually, the impact, just like recycling. We want to make a yard by yard, Deerfield 2030, a yard by yard kind of thing. And again, you know, one of the things that came up over and over again in the pandemic is the mental health. People feel overwhelmed with climate change, and they feel helpless. And so what I want to do is to show that cumulatively we can do stuff. And I'm so excited. The planning board approved our Leary lot. And one of the things that the conservation district has already agreed to do is do some kind of board with the thermometer, whatever. Our goal, once we get Nick Miller to give us the calculations of the flooding of the Bloody Brook, what we can do when we get the Leary lot done is to show the storage capacity for flooding by the pervious parking lot, the tree boxes, the rain gardens, everything that we're doing in the Leary lot will start the process. And our goal is hopefully we'll get the library to do pervious pavement. We'll get any project in town, in the village, doing the storage capacity so we can meet our goal of storing water in these intense rain events. There's a lot of things that we can do that are little, but that will draw in the community. And that's what we have to do. It has to be educational outreach. I realize we're doing a lot. Chris, I met with him yesterday, Chris Nolan, to try to figure out our social justice thing. We're very close to neighborhoods. When years ago, when we had a project that was almost brought forth, Sharon Pachorik and I literally knocked on doors, and we had 53% eligible for funding, you know, that was income appropriate. So there is segments in our village that could be social justice communities, and we need to identify those. We need to just take off the Deerfield Academy, Eagle Brook Historic Deerfield, because number one, even the housing, we collect no money on the houses, and their income is skewing us wicked. So just like we do for the educational formula, where we ask for the waiver to pull off the nonprofit property and the incomes associated with that, we need to do the same thing here so that we can focus in on the community that we're really addressing. And it's elders that are overhoused, lack you know, access to healthcare, transportation, all kinds of stuff. So we need our story. And I think you hit upon it already. And I know this, I sound like a broken record, but I honestly feel that this is the way to go for us.
Yeah, and so I'm going to be much shorter. I agree with everything Carolyn just said. We just need to really take that 67% in block four and bring it down below 65%, because I don't think that the state has necessarily the most up-to-date and accurate information about what's going on in our town. And Chris has been working on this, thankfully. So that's it.
I just want to add that Greenfield, the reason why Greenfield, no, their little social justice part, and in Sunderland, because your turnover, even if it's transient, you're turning it over to students and low-income populations. So they have, that really doesn't change. What we have to do is give more current information of who's in the apartments on Thayer Street, who is on whatever, living wherever in our village. And I think we definitely can do it. We can get that 67% down to maybe 62 or something like that with more accurate information.
So I'm going to also just put forward a plea to try and wrap this up by 11:30. So,
yeah, I have another meeting at noon, so I'm sorry.
Okay, we'll try to move things along here. So Wayne, you're looking for an approval of part A and then discuss the December meeting format for part completing part B.
Yes, I'm not, we should talk about time schedule, whether we're ready for December for part B. So,
okay.
So let me do that before you, but so part A, yes, approved. So we say we're done. Chris Nolan's already sent it to the state to allow us to go to the next process in doing this. The state doesn't approve it. You know, this is your section. You send it to them, but they don't have to approve it. So there's a format thing. So this is whether it's December or want to wait till January. The way the state thinks you should do part B is extremely time consuming. They want to wait till after you do the training. So that's one of the issues. You're supposed to do the training first. And then they want you all to do part B together, which is just time consuming. If you want to do that, that's absolutely wonderful. The approach that Chris Curtis and I spoke about is, do you want me to do the first draft of a part B, not to limit your flexibility whatsoever in making changes, but so that it's always easier to review a document than it is to write a document. So if you wanted that, I can sort of put together a part B and then you're spend time ripping it apart and adding to it, and it might be a more efficient use of your time, but it's your call how you do that.
I'm fine with that.
I just have a quick question, being the new kid on the block, 30-second description of what part B is.
So the first one was identifying who's out there. The second one is, okay, what does that mean? This is sort of what Carolyn was saying. What does that mean for who should be at the table? How do you engage? Because it's going to lead to the next part of this. I can't remember if it's a separate part. The next phase is a specific engagement plan as you come back to revise your MVP resilience. So, you know, how does that influence decisions that you make going forward?
Thank you.
That's where I would say that we want to do something like our climate forum with kids at the high school. I mean, I can call Stacy Chapley, who handles most of the science programs, and she worked with our soil health plan with the kids. Let me see if there's anybody that we can engage with or make one of her classes, you know, visit, you know, something at the town hall. So they feel like they're doing a little participation or something that we can engage with them. I really feel it strongly that we need to incorporate kids somehow.
Denise?
Yeah, I think to engage more people, first of all, they have to understand the overall concept of what's happening. And then I think people like specific tasks. I know I do. I like action. I like, you know, getting things done. So, I mean, it's great, you know. I don't want it to be where we have meetings to have more meetings to discuss things that need to be done and don't get, you know, accomplish anything. So I think you're going to get a lot more participation if you can identify specific tasks and timelines. So, you know, and maybe you have already. I don't know.
No, and I think it's what I want to start doing. That's the next phase. That's why the discussion is, do you want to do that together? Do you want me to put something out? I mean, you know, I'm hearing some guidance for what it would be.
So, Chris, I would like to suggest that Tom write the Part B to give us a draft to work on. So it just does make sense to have one person who's familiar with this stuff rough out a beginning point, and then we can read it and suggest changes that we think reflect our city, our situation better.
It would be really helpful to have it, you know, like a week ahead or something, so that we can think about it, and then it will be a more productive discussion.
Okay. The other thing, Carolyn, just to think about is, so Part A was sort of rigid, and there wasn't a lot of flexibility for putting things in. Part B, we start having a little more flexibility. So the thing that you've stressed in the past, Carolyn, about having your story ready for the next grant, that's what we hope to get out of Part B and engagement.
Right. And Chris, actually, if you could work with Chris Nolan, because he knows, without having to repeat it again and again, he knows the story that I'm trying to promulgate is our overhouse seniors, et cetera, et cetera. And so maybe you can work with him. And in the meantime, maybe I can figure out how we can reach some of the low-income seniors, since most of us here are seniors. But I don't consider us seniors. So we're talking about the elder seniors, the 80s and 90s. So if maybe there's somebody, if we can get one or two of those representatives on the committee that would be interested and able to participate, I think that would be huge to our story, because I think that's what we're trying. You know, we want to take to January to see the interaction in our MMA meeting with state agencies, our story. So the quicker we work on this, the quicker it will all feed in together, and we can keep refining it, just like our CCI, what we did in the CCI in the last couple of years. We want to be able to do the same thing with our story here. And we also have to fight back a bit, because otherwise, if we don't fight, we're I hate to say it, we're screwed, because, you know, we're never going to be able to be eligible for any money for anything, unless we try to reconstruct the narrative.
Well, I think you know this, but some grants are more rigid than others. I mean, some say give environmental justice community yes or no and you're done, and some give you the opportunity to tell your own story and figure out what you're doing.
Right. Well, that's what we have to do, is figure out where we're wasting our energy and then where we can focus in on.
So there are really two steps that come next after this Part B work. One is one that we can work on right away, which is recruiting the expanded core team, and Denise and Peter being added to the group is part of that for sure. But the other aspects are, you know, filling slots that represent these underrepresented groups that we just talked about. So Carolyn has suggested on the student side that Cece Yazwinski might be one of the students that we consider adding to the core team. I've also reached out to Frontier, to Stacy and another science teacher there who are connected with the Frontier Environmental Club, to see if we could get a representative from Frontier through that group. And I'm kind of waiting to hear back from them about that. On the seniors side, I've reached out to the Senior Center and Jennifer Remillard to see whether or not she might be able to identify someone in that older age group that we were just discussing.
How old do you have to be?
Well, I think older than us.
Well,
isn't that close enough?
That's pretty young. That's
I can do that job.
Yeah. So maybe we have that position filled, but I've reached out anyway to the Senior Center to see if there might be someone that would also fit the bill. And then on the farmer side, I reached out to CESA to see whether or not they might be able to identify a potential farmer that could fit the bill, someone who is both available to come to meetings and might have had some climate change impact to their farm crops or properties, especially in the last year, given all the damages that we had. And they were not really able to identify anybody specific, but they sent me the list of their active members. And, you know, I want to maybe just, since there's only a few of these, want to see if anybody, if this triggers any potential candidates from folks that you might happen to know. So their list was the Antonellis Farm, River Bard Farm, Open Palm Farm, Lily Pad Acres, Kingsbury Farm, Clarkdale Fruit Farm, Atlas Farm, and Mycoterra Farm. So they have maybe 10 members. For those of you that maybe know some of those folks, does that, you know, trigger any potential strong candidates that we might want to reach out to particularly?
I mean, we'd all love Ben Clark, but he truly doesn't have time.
Right.
Problem is, Ben does more than most farmers. Most farmers like Mikey Antonellis, I mean, they don't have time to even sleep. And that's one of the reasons we have an inactive agricultural commission, is because the true farmers are truly working and they just don't participate. Can't even get them to participate even on the conservation district, which gives them, is a funnel for money. So, but Chris, what I would like you to do is we can work together with Megan, my administrative assistant from the Conservation Commission, and we can try to identify some of the maybe smaller farms and try to get a woman or a person of color or a minority of some sort, because we're doing special outreach to those DEI kind of stuff on the conservation district. So she might have some more, a better list than you do, Chris. So that would be like a win-win.
Emma?
I'm thinking Barway Farms, Melnick's, they have the digester, methane digester. They're also just spoke to somebody about putting solar on some of their property. And they have a multi-generational group. So Steve is the senior member, but Peter, his son, is very engaged in alternative energy and things like that. And then their grandson, Henry, is also working on the farm, and he is, you know, college age. So, and so you've got, I think, you know, it's a pretty interesting group.
That's great. Tim, did you have a comment?
Yes, I just wanted to say, I'd like to make a motion that we ask CC Jaskiewicz to serve as a student. Is there a second?
Sure.
All right, there's been a moved and seconded. Now, any discussion about this? I just want to, you know, actually achieve something.
Thank you.
I will call
discussion. Sounds good.
All right, now let's vote.
Yeah.
So that we can let at least get something done. I vote yes.
Tim Hilche, yes.
Denise Mason, yes.
Eli, yes.
M.A. Sweetland, yes.
Kevin, I think you were voting member. Oh, no, you're not? Okay. All right. Great.
Yes. Okay. Well, Chris Nolan, yes.
So let's work on the farm thing a little bit more.
Well, I was going to suggest that if MA could talk to the Barway Farm team, see if any of them have the time and are interested, because I think that would be a useful viewpoint. And if not, then we move on to somebody else. We also have, although she's very busy on many boards, our finance chair has a roaming something farm and raises, you know, Highland cattle. So there are alternatives beyond the list. But I think the first step would be to let MA talk to Barway, unless other people have another person they think would be.
Well, Tim, the roaming farm idea is a good one. And given that those are my next door neighbors, I'd be happy to broach the subject with them if you think that's appropriate.
Yeah, I don't know. Both tracks, we could ask for both tracks. You know, have Barway and roaming. What's the full name of that, Chris?
The full name of what?
The whole name of her farm.
Roaming.
What's the name of the farm?
Which farm?
Not Barway.
Julie's farm.
Roaming farm.
Yeah. I mean, I'm happy with either of them. I mean, it's just that Julie is so busy. Perhaps her husband would be interested, but I don't know what he does for a day job.
Yeah, I think they're great ideas. It's Pete Lott. And I do have a meeting with Mike Antonellis tomorrow on a conservation commission. I know because he wants to put up a new barn. I don't know if you want me to just mention it to Mike while I'm there, or you want to go with the
Pete, the I think that would be lovely. The only hesitation is I know that poor...
I know they're out straight.
Yeah, he works himself to the bone. But
yeah.
If you could talk to him, I think, and tell him that we're really interested, I'd be glad to follow up as well.
I think I'm up there at like 9 or 9:30 tomorrow morning just to take a look at his site. So
I think it's really important to get this new generation involved. So it would be great.
All right.
Go ahead,
how many farmers do you want on this? Why don't you just start off with Barway? If that doesn't work, go on to Antonellis, then go on to Julie. Or, you know, I mean, because if you're asking too many people, they all say, yes, do you want that many people on? I don't know.
Right. I think we're only looking for one.
Yeah. Start with one. Can I make a suggestion about the seniors? I think that was a great idea, you know, the senior center. But, you know, since most of the seniors live right in the center of town, I don't know a lot of them. But if you ask a few key people, for instance, Sharon Pachorik, who knows everybody, and a few other seniors to identify, because I don't know if there's a way of identifying, you know, demographics of where the elder seniors live in town. And if so, and come up with, if we can identify them, then we can break up into teams and go and interview them. I'd be happy to do that. But, you know, if we could at least identify who they are and then, you know, what we're asking them to divulge.
Right. The next slide.
Can I ask Tom a question? What constituency do I fill and what constituency does Carolyn fill in this recipe? Because, I mean, we're both seniors. So if one of us is filling one nook, the other one can fill a different nook. And all we're trying to do is meet the 10 guideline. We're not trying to, you know, do anything else than that. Because, you know, occasionally people are not going to show up and we need to fill out this roster. So...
So you get to define this. Don't, I mean, the state is limited in what they're making you do. So
can you speak into the mic a little more?
So you get to define this. So don't feel pressure from the state. So, I mean, you've certainly already covered, the seniors, the people on the committee already are covering the seniors. The people who are probably least represented, the seniors now, are the people without access to transportation, the people who live in the village and maybe really rely on services. So if you can think about someone like that, and because you also want to get someone who can think from a lower income perspective, you know, it's fine for one person to fill two niches. So if you can think of a senior who doesn't have mobility, for example, or limited mobility, I mean, you know, actually owning a car type thing, that would be ideal, but don't feel like you have, there's one formula. Whatever works for you is your choice.
Okay, we'll work on it.
And what about having more than one student age person?
I think that would be great for two reasons, I think is what Carolyn was getting at. One is for you to hear their voices, and second, hopefully for them to be inspired and make this part of their life's work. Whether it's on the core committee, I mean, I think you need to have a youth on the core committee, but you already have that. You're welcome to get a second one if you want. I certainly think there seems to be support for focus groups with youth, so there's other ways to get them involved. So no need to find another youth unless you want to.
Yeah, I was just thinking that being the only under 20 on a group would be less welcoming than if there were another person who was in a similar age demographic.
Absolutely. And it may be, I don't know the age of your granddaughter, but it may be you want, in an ideal world, you know, a high school student and a Gen Z 20-something person.
Well, Cece's 14, but she certainly feels comfortable working with this committee, I'm sure. She's not shy. I mean, she's got opinions on stuff, which is really good. I just was hoping for someone, an additional person, like Tim was saying, but
yeah,
I just feel like we would truly more represent what we're trying to do if we had more involvement from the kids. And maybe just doing a focus group, it will evolve in the focus group. Cece has the ability to do Zoom meetings because of her schedule. Whereas, you know, the high school, you know, the public high school is a little bit less flexible. So we might need to change our meeting time, but, you know, to me, it would be worth it.
Right. I think that's a good point.
I need to know what message I'm taking. Can someone help me?
I'll talk to you offline about that.
Good. Thanks.
Okay. So the next step after we expand the core team, which hopefully we'll do quickly here, is to begin the state's set of prescribed trainings for our committee. And there are really two sets of trainings. One's titled Climate Resilience Trainings. And these are 3 one-hour sessions followed by a facilitated discussion afterwards. So hypothetically, that's going to take up our next 3 meetings to a large degree. And those are followed by equity and climate justice learning series trainings. And these are 3 90-minute workshop sessions that the state will set up. And these are Zoom meetings that we all participate in, that basically we sign up for a state-sponsored workshop. So those will take up a chunk of our next piece of work here. And, you know, again, I think it's important to get the committee's membership set up and the expanded committee set up before we embark on that. But hopefully we can start those in, ideally in December, was our thinking, assuming we can get everything else done. So, in thinking about that, I guess sort of talking about what our meeting schedule might be is the next topic on the agenda, how frequently we might be able to meet in order to kind of move through these training sessions, and what people's availability and schedule is. You know, we've been meeting at this on Wednesdays at 10:30 up until now, but that doesn't necessarily have to be the schedule, obviously. What are your thoughts about availability and schedule?
Well, I'll be 100% upfront. We need to have meetings that mean that we accomplish stuff, but also we were the first in the state, or one of the first in the state, MVP certified. So I want us to again be MVP 2.0 certified first. So however we work back, would be the frequency that I would be willing to meet. And the reason why is I think it's really important that as part of our narrative. We're the first with soil health planned in the state, and it feeds into our CCI and what we're trying to do, and it gives us our narrative. So I think everyone here is committed to get it done, and whether we have to do it a little bit faster is fine, I think, most of us. Denise?
I've got a question. So you're talking about all these trainings. Are these Zoom trainings, and can we do them individually and then get together after and have a discussion on them, or do we have to do them together?
Well, that's a good question. The first set of trainings, there's a video, and I'm not sure exactly how long the video is. Do you know,
Wayne? I thought it was an hour, but I thought you were the one who told me that.
Yeah, that's what it says. It says it's an hour in the, you know, in the materials that we've gotten from the state. We haven't seen them yet. And then there's supposed to be a discussion of certain questions after the video is done. So I guess hypothetically, people could watch the videos individually, and then we could have the discussion as at our meeting, or we could watch them together. That's no,
let's do it to individually.
It wouldn't be nice. I mean, we might be able to plow through this a little faster. I'm looking at what's at the end of the rainbow here.
Yeah.
Well, we get the first through the door for the next pot of money. The reason why the MVP worked for us, because we were one of the first in the state.
Yep.
And so they were giving out $400,000 or $500,000 at a time. That's how we got Kelleher Drive. That's how we got Mill Village Culvert done. But now they're giving out like 20, 30, 40, 50,000 because it's the same 20 million for 300 and something towns versus a handful of towns. So the idea is make it through the door so we get the first round or two of new money so we can really do something.
So how can we do it as quick as possible? That's my question.
What I have in mind is maybe doing the pervious surface of the library. We know it's going out to bid, and we could put it into, if we are 2.0 certified and we tell them our story, we could do a storage capacity for flooding with the library parking lot. That in the back of my mind, that's like, maybe we could do that. They don't do parking lots, but maybe they will do something along those lines. If it's a storage capacity thing, so we can make it have more capacity. I don't know. We'll see.
And remember, you've already been funded for the seed program. So that's part of this. So you get to do some implementation next fiscal year without applying for any new funding.
Well, that's why we want to push for this too.
And to just answer Denise, your question about end of rainbow, Carolyn's right about the end of the rainbow is to get more action grant funding.
Right.
But the end of the rainbow for MVP 2.0 is that we are going to be updating the town's MVP plan. And the plan lays out the specific projects that the town wants to seek funding for. So we have one that's now 5-6 years old, and we've literally almost done everything in the plan. We've gotten, you know, 5 action grants, and we have made a lot of progress. So we need a new set of priorities. We need to think through what's next. And that's the big piece of work that the committee will be doing under MVP 2.0 is really updating those priorities.
Okay, thank you. Makes
sense.
Yep.
Okay, so I think what I'm hearing is that we want to explore the possibility of watching these videos individually and then spending meeting time with the discussions of what we learned from the videos and what we can take forward. So I'll explore that and see if that's possible. And then the question is meeting frequency. Do we want to continue meeting once a month, or do we want to try to pick up the pace and do it every 2 weeks, for example? Is that too much for people? I know we got the holidays coming up.
I think it depends on what you lay out for us as the workload. I mean, I don't really have a handle on the workload. So, Chris, I think I need to see your proposal on that rather than just say every 2 weeks.
Right.
If we could knock out a couple videos at a time, each of us take notes on them, then have one meeting that we can discuss multiple videos. That sounds great to me.
Yeah,
and that would move us along a little faster.
The other thing is, I've got my hand up, and I just want to ask.
You know, there's no point in putting my hand up if we're just going to talk over each other. I need to understand, when do we qualify for, when do we become designated as the first MVP 2.0 in the state? Do we have to finish all these trainings first? Or what will get us to the point where we can say we're the first in the state to be accepted?
Yes, you're supposed to do the trainings first.
Yeah. Okay, so it would make sense for us to try and figure out a method where we can all do what we're required to do as quickly as possible. So do we want to let Chris and Tom figure out how we can do this and then recommend, make a recommendation either by email with links, so we don't have to wait till the next meeting to talk about this again?
Can I just make sure you understand one thing about the calendar? So I'm not sure exactly when the state considers you certified. You'll be doing your updated resilience plan this fiscal year. You'll be planning your seed plan this fiscal year, but you wouldn't actually be doing your seed plan until next fiscal year because they haven't given you the money for that yet. And then you won't be able, and there's a feedback loop you want after you do the seed plan. So you won't do the final part of this process until next fiscal year, no matter what. But you get to do your resilience plan sooner and potentially get it done in time for this fiscal year's action grant application in the spring.
So I'm just trying to figure out what is it that triggers our ability to be make an application to become certified. I mean, if the training's not related to that, or is it putting together a plan for what we want to do with the seed money? I mean, I'm just trying to understand what physically triggered.
Yeah, I mean, the order they want is do the training so that you're informed, do that part B that I'm going to work on with you, do the engagement plan, do some community forums, and then revise the plan. So in theory, it's a serial process. In practice, we're going to, in terms of what Carolyn was saying, we're going to try to do them somewhat in parallel. So like, I will start working on the part B today, even though you can't actually do your review until you finish the training. So we're trying to do them back to back, but
okay.
And Tim, I think
the idea is to be ready for the spring round because it is only once a year. So if we have jumped through the hoops by the spring, then we can apply for the next round in grants. Otherwise, we have to wait until the following year.
And Chris, you were.
I was going to say, you know, there's five steps in the first year process, ending with the update of the community's resilience priorities and the update of the plan. And I would think that when we submit that updated plan to the state and get it approved, that sort of answers your question about when we're hypothetically certified. I don't know if they use that word.
Right.
We're done with that first phase. So, yeah, I think we can accelerate that process pretty well. As far as the action grant, just one detail about that, the letters of intent for the action grant that starts next spring are actually due, I believe, in December. So that doesn't really sync up terribly well with our schedule here, but we could put in a letter of intent with what we know at that point. I'll have to get you the exact date, but it's much sooner than you might imagine for the next round.
Chris, am I right that that's letter of intent is optional to get feedback? It's not required?
I thought it was required.
Maybe they changed it. Okay.
Yeah. So.
We can come up with something. I'm not worried about that.
Okay.
We need to know the date that it's due.
Yeah. I'll get that out to you by email.
Denise.
Yeah, another question. So you said we have to have community forums too before we can do this?
Yes, before
you. Okay. So can we, I mean, since we need to know, we've got an application date in the spring, we have to have community forums. Why don't we do timeline and work backwards? We can plan the community forums already so we know when they're going to be, and then think about how many trainings we have, how many we can pack into, so we can probably zoom through this pretty fast.
Right.
But be efficient.
That's a great suggestion, Denise.
Did you share this, the rough timeline we had done?
I don't think so.
Okay. So Chris and I did a rough timeline more from a workflow standpoint, but we can work together and sort of beef it up with real dates and schedule meetings, that kind of thing.
Perfect. The other thing I'm having Chris Nolan do is our hazardous mitigation plan expires in 2025. And, you know, we've been traumatized in the past where we've had it done, stamped by MEMA, and it sat with FEMA. And we actually lost about $800,000 grant because of to fix Little Meadow Road, because, you know, we didn't have an active approved hazardous mitigation plan. So part of the hazardous mitigation plan is to have community meetings. And so some of these meetings can be construed as also qualifying for the hazardous mitigation process. So having Chris sort of organize the MVP in parallel with the renewal of that hazardous mitigation is huge too, because the same people, Kevin, John Bachorek, as our EMD, and, you know, we have the fire departments, and you're supposed to invite the schools and everything. So some of these public forums qualify as public meetings for the hazardous mitigation process. So, I mean, this is like the fourth plan that I've been involved with, and I think we can start this process. We just have to make sure that we're careful too, that we document everything. So it's a double, you know, win for a couple things here. Because otherwise, if you don't have a current plan, you're not eligible for like our road works, like Mass Works or brick grants and everything like that. So we have to pay attention to that.
Okay. So we will coordinate with Chris to try to make sure that happens.
Pete.
Just looking at the clock, and we're kind of winding out of time here. So this question's if we could find out about the video training, if we could do that on our own, that's probably a real priority to set, because we could probably whip through 3 1-hour videos on our own before the next meeting, yeah. Whether it's in 2 weeks or 4 weeks, we can get that done. And then the question on that I have in my mind, the equity and climate justice, the 3 90-minute sessions via the state, are those in the can now, or do we have to wait for the state to develop them and schedule them on their own, or is that something we can push forward with as well?
I asked that question of our state coordinator, whose name is Andrew Smith, and he said that I believe the videos are in the can, so to speak, but they haven't set up a schedule yet of when they're going to actually invite people to participate in them. So we are kind of held hostage to the state on that one. But, you know, they said that they were looking at December through February as a time frame for those to happen, roughly speaking.
Perfect. That's with our timeline.
Yeah. So given the shortness of time here, I want to jump ahead to the MVP action grant updates. So we have a little bit of time on that. So there's three pieces to the action grant. The first is the construction of green infrastructure in historic Deerfield. That one is where the project where we're going to be installing a tree box filter in front of the Deerfield Inn. And we need to get started on the engineering piece of that, because there has to be an underground scan done of the area where it's going to go. And so I wanted to talk to you about the status of the contract with EBI Engineering, which I sent to the select board and recommended that you approve. Is there a concern about that? I know that hasn't been approved yet, and I'm a little bit worried that our schedule is going to get slowed down here if we don't get started shortly.
To be honest, Chris, we're working with Berkshire Design, so we really want Berkshire Design to handle that. Is that going to be a problem?
You know, I think it's possible, but it would definitely set us back if we did if we we're going to use Berkshire Design for both the Leary lot and the green entryway at DES.
Mm-hmm.
The historic Deerfield piece, because EBI did all of the previous work on it, and they specifically put together the quote for the ground penetrating scan. I think if we tried to change horses in midstream on that, that's going to set us back time-wise. It's your call, obviously, and I don't work for EBI. I'm not trying to promote them in any way, but I think in the interest of getting the project done in a timely way, that's probably our best bet.
Can we just, can I just ask you, I will call Jeff Squires and head of Berkshire Design and have him call you, because they've been really accommodating to us, like working with us on our town projects. So I feel like they would be accommodating for this. I don't know. Tim, how do you feel?
Well, I have two questions. I mean, when is this project likely to be done? This year or next year?
Well, it has to be done by the beginning of June of next year. So presumably, you know, if we got the work begun on the remaining engineering work now, we could shoot for, you know, as soon as the ground is available in the spring to do the installation. It's not a super complicated project because this one is only a single tree box filter.
Right. And do we have a cost that EBI, or has this got to go out to bid? I mean, I don't.
Do we have a budget for the engineering?
Yeah, I mean,
that's the question. Yes.
Yeah, the engineering and oversight portion of this thing. Do we have an overall cost for installing it? I assume we do.
Yes,
we have. What portion of that is dedicated to either EBI or Berkshire Design overseeing it?
Yes, we have distinct budgets for both the construction administration piece and for the actual installation work, which would be done through a different vendor.
Right. So I guess my only point is it's like whether it's Berkshire Design or EBI, there's a specified budget for that part of it. So we're not going to save money by switching from EBI to Berkshire Design.
No.
Well, there's a specific budget. That's correct.
Okay. So that makes it easier. And on the one hand, I agree with, you know, we've got one vendor we've been working with on a bunch of different projects. On the other hand, if we put all our eggs in one basket, do we create a problem because they stop being responsive because, you know, we seem to be working with them exclusively? So, I mean, I don't know.
Well, that part right there, Tim, you can head right off and say, hey, look, can you handle this or you're not going to handle it? And if you're going to treat us bad, let me know now and I'll walk away. Mm-hmm. I mean, you just need to be straightforward with these people. You know, the double tapping, the dancing around, you just got to come right out and say, look, this is what we're doing. This is what we need. Can you do it? Period. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I think, Tim, this is a posted select board meeting. So how about I call Jeff. Jeff can connect with Chris. If Jeff can do the timeline, commit to doing this, fine. If he can't, then we'll default to EBI. Would you support that motion?
Sure.
Okay. So all those in favor?
Tim Hilchey, aye.
Carolyn Ness, aye. So Chris, we'll move forward on the contract one way or the other, okay? But I would like to see if Berkshire Design, because they're local and we have been working with them successfully, I would like to see if we could get them to do this. But it will absolutely have to be done on the timeline that we'll get this done, okay? So so that's your answer, all right? And I'll come in and sign the contract with whoever we end up with, okay?
Okay.
And if I just may butt in from a contract administration perspective, we have that draft contract with EBI, and we could also use the town standard engineering contract template to draft a similar one with Berkshire Design, and whichever one ends up being logistically more advantageous, we can put before the board at a future meeting.
Yeah. So we'll move ahead with that. Okay, Chris?
Okay.
Chris Curtis.
Yes. All right. Second project is the construction of the Leary Lot green infrastructure. Chris and Denise, you could do a quick update on the planning board hearing and how that went. And I guess it got approved.
Sure. I think the hearing went really well. I had attended one of the Leary Lot meetings, so I did have some prior information, and then I read through all the information I think that, you know, everyone had, and we were really happy about the pervious pavement, the planting of all the trees and native trees, also the EV chargers. And yeah, I mean, I don't think we had a problem. I think the only question that we had was as far as the driveway onto Elm Street, whether that should be two-way or one-way, but we figured once construction's, you know, started, that'll pan out. I know the chief said he's happy with two-way, but I think overall, I think it was a really good meeting. You know, there were a couple of questions about sweeping that I still had, I think backing. That'll all be figured out.
They actually
out.
Back, but
yeah, well, yeah, no, out there. Yeah, in the information that I had, it said vacuumed monthly and right. Maybe power washed. And so there, you know, there that was a big question. And then I've heard others that it's, you know, twice a year. So
yeah, you normally from what I've talked to a few different people that have had it for a little while, the power washing really, unless you start seeing it a problem. Other than that, you do the vacuuming, like you said, yeah. At least twice a year. You know, fortunately, you know, we use chemical instead of salt or instead of sand. On our roadways and our parking lots. So that right there alleviates, you know, half the problem. You know, the only thing you are going to get is you're going to get like a couple other areas that very close to there, they do use sand. With that being said, literally it does track in because you can actually watch the track, which is basically means in the springtime, you just got to deal with it then. So,
right. Right. But all in all, we were very happy with all the materials, with the presentation, all the research that was done. So yeah, and we did not require a peer review, which is good.
That's
for the
exciting team. It's moving ahead. I'm about ready yeah. to cheer.
And Pete Law did the CONSCOM came back saying that they didn't have it wasn't within a resource area, so you didn't have a comment, is that right?
Yeah, no, it wasn't jurisdictional to us, so the resource area was outside. So nice. I sat in on the meeting and
Great.
So there were two issues that I think I brought up earlier. One is that we needed to add one more tree box filter into the design plan. Chris, do you know if that happened?
So yeah, I talked to Jeff about that. He said that the drawing actually did incorporate two of them, and it was a little bit hard to see on the map, but they were both there. So okay. I think he responded to you, but if he didn't, let me know. And
no, okay. He didn't, but that's okay. Good.
I'll get in touch
here. And then we're supposed to have one more community-wide forum under the MVP grant for this project. Is that, do you see that being feasible at this point?
Absolutely. We could do a follow-up meeting. And we can incorporate it. We can meet as a select board at 5 o'clock and have between 5 and 6 neighborhood feedback on what is happening. I think that's a good PR thing anyway, and it keeps people informed, and we can't help it if they don't go to meetings. So, I mean, we can have it out there, you know, it can be in the newspaper. We're really excited about doing stuff. So there's no problem with that, Chris.
I think that's a great idea, Carolyn, and I want to suggest maybe that I can help you by doing a little bit broader community outreach to kind of get people maybe to show up for that. I could do a newspaper, you know, thing and try to get an article in the paper, and then maybe do a flyer that gets distributed to some of the businesses and property owners, if that makes sense.
Perfect. And then you can, that way you can emphasize the pervious pavement is being a storage flood storage capacity issue that we're addressing. You know, sort of like we're modeling this on Cambridge, where they're literally burying 2 million gallon tanks, 22 million gallon tanks to hold storage water. And what we want to replicate that in as many projects as we can. So that would be great, Chris. That's good, you know, get people used to the idea of it anyway.
Okay, so we just need to figure out what date we're going to go with on that. Do you have one in mind now, or should we talk later?
Well, we certainly can do it in December. Just looking at our calendar, we could do it December 13th at 5 o'clock at our just prior to our select board meeting. Or if that's too early, you know, 5 to 6 isn't enough, then we could, you know, roll into the select board meeting. Is that okay?
I think that's great. I think 5 o'clock sounds like a reasonable time.
Sure.
Okay, excellent. And then the third project under the action grant is the construction of the green entryway at Deerfield Elementary School. Darius Modesto, the superintendent, is kind of taking the lead on that project, and he's looking to bid the MVP portion of the project jointly with the sort of hardscape portion of the project. So in other words, there's they're going to repave the entryway, the pavement portion of the project. That's going to be paid for separately by the town and the school district. And then the green portions of the project, which are all the landscaping and rain gardens and so forth, would be paid for under the MVP grant. Two projects will run in parallel. And so Darius is, I think, currently negotiating a contract with Berkshire Design. He's decided that they would be, he thinks, the best choice to do the construction oversight piece. And I don't know that he's finished that contract yet. Has the select board seen one yet?
I don't believe so, Chris. Have we?
I have not. I haven't heard from him since we had the discussion on his decision to look towards Berkshire Design as the contractor to work with on that. But I can follow up with him.
I know it's moving ahead, Chris Curtis, because I was at the rural school aid roundtable with him on Monday, and I had asked him how it was going. So they're moving on it a little bit. But you're right, I haven't seen a contract.
Okay. So that's really where we stand with that one. And Chris and I can both kind of follow up and check on the status of the negotiations there.
Chris, a quick question. Will any of the money that the school and the town are spending on the hardscaping, paving, whatever they're doing, will that in any way be considered matching for or only the, you know, I don't know.
It's not how we set the grant application up there. That was not included really in the grant fund scheme.
Right. Okay. Because I know that some of the other, it seemed like that the maximum we would spend would be like whatever it was, 90,000, I forget the number, but that some of the projects had a built-in, this could be considered match, whether it's in kind or whatever. So am I wrong or?
In this case, the hardscape really is an entirely separate thing.
Yeah, no, I get that. I'm talking about the other two things, the Leary lot and the tree box and the old Deerfield.
Yeah, there is specific, you know, Tim, maybe it'd be best if I just talk to you offline about the details of the match. There is specific match in the grant application for both of those that are laid out in a fair amount of detail.
Yep.
Okay. So that brings us to other business. Does anybody have any other agenda items or business that you want to talk about?
No, but let's just go over the tasks. So Chris, do you want to continue to reach out to Frontier, or do you want me to call Stacy and follow up?
You know, I think it would help, Carolyn, frankly, if you wouldn't mind making a call to her. I will continue to try to be in touch with her, but I haven't heard anything back. I did have an initial contact with Stacy and a second science teacher whose name I've forgotten right at the moment.
Yeah. I will, because I'm, and then the other tasks, I don't mind calling Sharon Pachorik and trying to find a low income senior. Do you want to do that, or were you going to follow up with Jennifer Remillard?
I don't know her, so if someone that does know her could do that, that would be great.
All right, Denise and I, I'll call Sharon, and then if she doesn't come through, then Denise and I will work on that.
Hey, Carolyn, does it make sense, since Cece did go to Frontier? I mean, does she know someone? So she could potentially know someone that she went to school with.
I'll try to.
Okay.
Yeah. We're trying to get an Envirothon team over there, and the Conservation District has volunteered to pay for it. And there just doesn't seem to be that much interest. And have to say I'm a little discouraged with that, since we were willing to pay for it. But anyway, I'll follow up with Stacy and see where we're at that, and I'll follow up. So then, Chris, you're going to get us the trainings and forward it to everybody that's here, right?
Yes, and we'll get you a schedule kind of based on Denise's suggestion of working back from a target date.
Perfect.
And give you all the details of that. And I guess we really just need to identify our next meeting.
Well, I'm supposed to talk to the Mel Barway Farm.
Yep, and MA's got the Barway Farm.
Yeah.
And then I still think it's worth just floating the idea, Pete, to Mikey Antonellis. Just to say what we're doing, you can just give them a little background and say, you know, would you be at all interested or whatever? And then, and then I can follow up if the Melnicks fall through. I think it would be really nice to get Henry involved. He'd be a kind of a twofer, a younger.
Yeah.
Because I know
that's what I'm going to try and go for.
Yeah. Because Peter was on the Conservation District and he dropped out a few years ago because he just didn't want to spend the time. So that's one of the reasons I'm concerned about them, you know, participating. But Henry might be willing. So that's great. So let's go for Henry. Young and farmer. That's a twofer.
How do you feel about, it might not be that bad to have a second farmer if we could actually get to it. Do you want me to talk to Roaming Farm and Julie's husband, Steve?
Well, why don't we wait a minute, because poor Julie is on everything, and Julie can certainly join in, and we can get her to join in if we need her at some point. But she would do it if we asked her. But again, she's like Ben Clark. She's got so much going on.
I was thinking about her husband, actually, Steve.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's fine.
And then the last thing is Tom is writing something for us to look at.
Right. So
what dates do we want to look at for the next meeting?
Wayne, yes.
Oh, Wayne, I'm sorry. I keep saying Tom. I'm thinking of...
I knew you meant me. It's okay.
You know what it is that the Sunderland former Select Board member, Tom Fidenkevich, and I'm thinking Wayne Fiden, and then it's, my head is just, yeah. My apologies, Wayne.
No problem.
You say we are all seniors on this committee?
Yeah.
Yeah, senior moment.
So what about Wednesday, December 6th? How does that?
I will be away, but you probably don't need me if that's mostly the training.
Well, it'd be nice if we could have you there.
Any chance the week before?
How about Wednesday, November 29th?
Sure.
Would that be 10:30, sir?
Well, that's a question too. Is 10:30 a good time for people to meet?
You know who isn't available is Lori Busada at 10:30, and she has been an active member for a long time, but she could meet after school. So maybe we could have a later meeting.
So can I propose something?
Sure.
Since we don't know, ideally before we start having the training discussions, we have a finalized core team. That way we don't have to repeat anything. So I think by the next time we meet, we want to pretty much have that fully squared away. We want to have everybody finalized. And because we don't know what everybody's individual schedule is going to be, I can send out a scheduling poll once we get a little bit closer to the end of the month, and hopefully we have a few more people appointed by then, and then go from there. Does that sound okay to everybody?
Yeah.
That's a great idea. Yeah,
that sounds good. And I wanted to ask, we will be adding a planner economic developer. Is there a role for that person on this core group? Would that fill out something? I don't know. I'm just throwing it out there because obviously.
Yeah, absolutely, Tim. What's the schedule for getting that person on board?
Chris December Nolan. 4th. December 4th or something yeah, like that.
That yeah. was my understanding was the first day.
Actually, could we think about Thursday the 30th rather than the 29th? I just realized I have the Mass Association of Conservation District annual meeting that whole afternoon.
Not available in the morning.
Well, maybe we could just pick the 30th and then.
Why don't we just do the 29th in the morning?
Yeah, I'm not available.
Okay. All right.
I'll give a lot of different options in the scheduling poll because if we have more people and everybody's on a different schedule and some people can't meet during the day and vice versa, I think it'll be good and we'll go with the option that has hopefully everybody available, but if not, then the most people.
Okay.
Yeah. Excellent. Thanks for your help with that.
Sure.
I had a couple of announcements.
Go ahead.
Is this a good time?
Yeah.
Okay. One of the things I talked to Carolyn and Tim on this is the
can you speak a little louder, MA?
The Green Communities 2.0 climate leadership communities. We're trying to get a letter of intent in by Friday. And I suggested that the Energy Committee do that application. I'm pretty sure that's okay. But it's if we qualify by jumping through a variety of hoops, which I sent to, I think I sent that to Carolyn and I just sent it to you, Chris. But one, you know, there's several things that the town needs to do like they did with Green Communities. And once we qualify as a climate leader community, we will be able to apply for solar grants for municipal buildings. And so I am really encouraging, I just want to let people know about that. And I think it's really going to be a good program.
MA, so I'll make the motion to support the Energy Committee sending the letter for, what did you call it again? The Green Letter of Interest to the Green.
It's for climate leadership communities.
Climate leadership communities. I make that motion.
A second.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Tim Hilchi, aye.
Carolyn Ness, aye. So, MA, you can go ahead.
Okay, thanks.
Easy enough.
the other thing, I forgot what the other thing is.
So I will fill out something. Kevin Scarborough and the DPW are going to be taking possession of the solar tracker that NewPro is donating to the town. And they're most likely going to be doing this on Monday of next week. We've got a letter from NewPro's attorneys saying that they and their parent company are giving this to us and that we have permission to be on the property to disassemble it. And we will be working with Greenfield Solar Advisor to help tell us how to take it apart. Did I miss anything, Kevin?
Dig Safe was cleared yesterday.
Perfect.
So excellent. We should be good to go.
And then the intent is for Eric Niels, our sewer supervisor, to find a place down at the South Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Facility and have it installed in the spring.
And that can be stored down there in the meantime, or?
We'll find everything will be stored properly. Okay. Things that need to be inside will be inside, and things that need to be outside will be outside.
Perfect. Excellent.
Things that need to be standing straight up and down will stay straight up and down.
Yep.
I think it's fabulous. Is any way to
and talk? I really want to thank the DPW in advance. I mean, we appreciate the your willingness to take on yet another task, Kevin. I know you don't have enough to do.
Yeah, no, just kind of sitting around.
Yeah, yeah.
Kind exactly. of looking at each other in the
you
corner.
You come into these meetings, spending an hour and a half. So, thank you.
No problem. It's all part of the job.
Well, it impacts our operating costs, so I really appreciate it, Kevin.
Yeah, I'm a taxpayer, too.
Yep. It'll generate 12 megawatts of power a year. So cool. That's
it'll, it needs it down there. Yeah. Because we all know both of our plants, my understanding is they're the ones that suck the most power out of the entire town. So,
yeah, they do.
Yeah.
We'll definitely see some savings from that.
Yeah, definitely. So, and that'll all be behind the meter. So that's good.
I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to run here in just a second.
Is there any other business that anybody else wants to bring up?
Well, I just want to say thank you to Denise and Pete. I really appreciate you stepping up for one additional more meetings all the time.
I love meetings, Carolyn. I live for meetings.
What else have we
done? We are actually accomplishing stuff and we will get money.
I know.
And thanks in advance for everyone's understanding when I cut people off and try to move the meeting forward faster.
I love that, Tim.
No, please, thank you.
I am not offended, Tim.
It was a really good discussion today. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you all.
Participating. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, thanks all.
You'll see a scheduling poll from me hopefully soon.
Thank you. Bye-bye.